My name is Mike Toledo, the CEO of the Hispanic Center here in Reading. And again, on behalf of the entire staff, our board of directors, we want to thank you for giving of your time to be here for this very important meeting. Before we get started, given the challenges and the pain and suffering that's going on the island and in Mexico, we want to start with a prayer before we get this meeting going. So we're going to have our partners from Salvation Army share a prayer with us in English. And then Monsignor Ursulac, who's here from St. Peter's, will give a prayer in Spanish, and then we'll get started.
Thank you. Will you join with me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we gather here today in this place as your children. Lord, we ask that you would draw near where we have anxiety and fear. Lord, bring your peace. Lord, where we have doubts, bring your wisdom. Lord, we ask that you would bless this time together as we think about our friends, our family who are in Puerto Rico. Lord, may you bring them comfort and safety. Meet needs. Lord, may your hands of abundance pour out what's needed. Lord, may your people be your hands and feet. May we go boldly and give with open hands generously as you've given to us. Lord, may we find your wisdom in our conversation, and may you lead and guide us in the plans that we make today. For it's for your people and for your kingdom that we work. Lord, bless our time. Bless us. In Christ's name, amen.
Oremos. Señor Dios, tú estás siempre con aquellos que sufren y nos animas a hacer lo mismo. Bendice nuestra reunión esta tarde, que nos ayude a facilitar los esfuerzos de los residentes de Reading y Berks County en sus tentativos a ayudar a la gente en necesidad, particularmente en la isla de Puerto Rico. Te lo pedimos en tu nombre, tú eres Dios por los siglos de los siglos. Amén. Amén.
Again, I'm very thankful for everyone who's here today. I know some of us have agenda items in front of them. Again, we didn't expect this kind of crowd, so we went and we're printing off some more, which is a good thing. But on our agenda item, we're going to try to touch on many different facets of what's going on and how we as a collective community can have the impact that we're looking for. The first thing we wanted to try to talk about was just an update on what is happening on the island, and hearing it directly from organizations that are on the ground. So at this time, again, I'd like to again bring up again Mr. Tressler here from the Salvation Army, who will speak to what is happening on the ground with the Salvation Army, the work that they are doing. And then we'll hear from the Red Cross as well in terms of what the work that they are doing, and talk a little bit about an update that we received from FEMA in terms of the work that they're doing, what the challenges that they're running into, and the support that they're looking for from us here in the United States.
Well, thank you. The Salvation Army, having a presence before the storm in Puerto Rico in multiple locations, our core community centers, and churches. We were there, and many of our officers and church members, employees experienced the storm firsthand, and have come out to serve others and to do everything possible since the storm. That being said, excuse my poor Spanish pronunciation, but we have core community centers that are serving meals in San Juan, Luisa, Fajardo, Humacao, Guayama, Ponce, Arecibo, Mayagüez, Penuelas, and Caguas. Each of those locations are serving as many meals as we can muster. We're serving about 16,000 meals a day. There are 8 of our mobile kitchens, mobile canteens on the island. And to this date, we haven't dispatched them to start serving meals in the more remote areas because we've been struggling to get food. There are container ships, large ships that have capsized in the port in San Juan, so it's made shipping in really difficult. As of just a day or two ago, the airport being opened, we began flying supplies and food in. With FEMA taking over the operations now, with the Jones Act being waived, the help has begun flowing much quicker, which is really great news because there are many people who desperately need it. Our desire is to start ramping up more meals in those locations and start sending out those 8 canteens into multiple locations around those communities. There'll probably be 1 canteen stationed at each core location, and they'll go out from there. I guess that's all I really have right now, except that fuel and electricity are issues as well. And that fuel is one of the reasons that we haven't sent the canteens out, because fuel being a very limited commodity, the fuel's being used to keep emergency generators running in hospitals and keeping the governmental vehicles, police, emergency responders, keeping their vehicles running, as well as roads, many roads still being impassable. The military is now on site, I've seen within the last 24 hours, and the Marines and the Army and the Navy CDs are there with chainsaws, cutting up trees, taking power lines out of the roads, and trying desperately to get these remote communities especially opened up so help can get to them. The sheltering, I'll allow the Red Cross to speak to, but that's all I can speak to about the meals right now. But we will be ramping up our numbers of meals daily as well.
So if people wanted to know where those locations are at, could they go to your website? Can they call your Salvation Army? So in case family members back home and back in Puerto Rico are asking, hey, I don't have food, and we just heard very specific towns where there's food being served, how can they find out where to direct people to?
I will have someone post the exact addresses in each of those communities where our core community centers are, where we're distributing meals as well as in-kind items, clothing and whatnot, as it's available. We're distributing those as well. But I will have that on the what is our Facebook page? It's Salvation Army Reading, I believe. If you just search for Reading Salvation Army on Facebook, you'll find us. So it'll be on there.
Thank you. So, en parte de la responsabilidad que yo tengo es para traducir lo que estamos hablando aquí y me quedé sentado. Así que el mensaje más importante que él compartió es que Salvation Army tiene localizaciones específicas en Puerto Rico que están dando comida. Y quiero asegurarme que ustedes sepan, por si acaso tienen familia en estos pueblos o conocen gente que viven cerca de esos pueblos y están diciendo que no tenemos comida. Les pueden indicar que pueden presentarse aquí y el Salvation Army está dando comida. Los pueblos son San Juan, Luisa, Fajardo, Humacao, Guayama, Ponce, Arecibo, Mayagüez, Penuelas y Caguas. Perdón, sí. Voy a decirlo un poquito más lento. Además, él lo van a poner, lo van a publicar en la página de web del Salvation Army, pero lo voy a decir una vez más. Donde están dando comida es San Juan, Loíza, Humacao, Guayama, Ponce, Arecibo, Mayagüez, Penuelas y Caguas.
A la hora.
Voy a coger la oportunidad para introducirme. Yo soy el doctor Yamil Sánchez Rivera, yo soy el vicepresidente de United Way. Y de suerte estamos en este edificio. Quiero aplaudir, agradecer y darle el honor a Mike Toledo. Porque como líder del Centro Hispano, él rápidamente fue arriba y dijo, tenemos que hacer algo. Tenemos que comunicar con la comunidad lo que está disponible, lo que está pasando y qué podemos hacer como un grupo. Lo voy a repetir en inglés. So since I've got the mic, I'm going to take an opportunity to introduce myself. I'm Dr. Yamil Sanchez Rivera. I'm the Senior Vice President for Community Impact at United Way. And I'm lucky that I'm on the sixth floor here because when people weren't reacting, Mike came upstairs and said, we need to do something. So I want to recognize his leadership, thank him for that, to facilitate this conversation. This is only the beginning of conversations and should not be the only, as I hear other people are coming together. By making sure that we are informing our community about what is happening and what is not, what we can do and what we shouldn't do, will ultimately help out the people in Puerto Rico. Equally so, we have a responsibility for the people here in Berks County. And that's why United Way believes that this is a role that we should be at. This isn't a typical responsibility that the Senior Vice President of Community Impact would play. But our people here in Reading and Berks County are hurting. If you see or hear any tears or knots in people's throat, it's because we're hurting too. And part of the conversation is, how do we help the people that are in Berks County be able to deal, be able to communicate, be able to support the people, whether it's in Puerto Rico or in Mexico? So I'm going to pass the microphone over to our representative from the American Red Cross, Matthew. We'll talk about what they are doing specifically in Puerto Rico, and I'll translate as we go along.
Good afternoon. I'm based here in Berks County. And I just first want to say thank you to Yamil, thank you to Mike for having us be able to provide you with an update. The first I would like to update you on is shelters. We've been receiving calls within the office from family members asking where their family members within Puerto Rico can go to. The American Red Cross actually does not run the shelters in Puerto Rico, it's the government. That being said, we work in conjunction and we partner up with the government and we have volunteers there right now. In fact, we have over 500 volunteers in Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands. If you want to know what shelters are open, not just in Puerto Rico, but across the country, you can go to AmericanRedCross.org, get help. It's on the top right corner of our webpage. When you click on that, it will show you a map, and you can go directly to Puerto Rico and see all the shelters. As of today, I know there's well over 75 shelters that are currently open in Puerto Rico. Other efforts that we are doing, we've distributed 20,000 comfort kits, 6,000 blankets, 5,000 cleanup kits, 8,000 tarps, and thousands of flashlights, batteries, dust masks, and hand sanitizer. We are also providing generators, laptops, satellite phones, and radios. With that, we're also providing water, food, and emergency distribution of other materials.
Okay. La Cruz Roja no está en el negocio de manejar los refugios que están en sitios de emergencia. Así que esa no es la responsabilidad primaria que tienen ellos. Pero como es tan grande lo que está pasando en Puerto Rico, en este momento sí están ayudando. Pero la responsabilidad de los refugios es una responsabilidad del gobierno de FEMA, del gobierno federal. La ayuda que están dando a la gente, la ayuda inmediata para poder sobrevivir, han dado 20,000 paquetes con cosas básicas, 6,000 colchas, 5,000 paquetes para poder limpiar las calles, las casas, 8,000 colchas o tapas para las casas, para la gente que perdieron ventanas, perdieron puertas, perdieron techo. Y están también dando generadores, computadoras y teléfonos satélites para poder conectar a la gente con la gente, a la gente en Puerto Rico con su familia acá.
And in the information I'm providing, I have copies that you can, I believe, is going to be up at the front table that you can take both in English and Spanish.
Vamos a dejar copias de lo que está hablando, van a estar en la mesa al frente, están en inglés y en español. La otra cosa, si ustedes se registraron cuando llegaron, ojalá que dieron su correo electrónico para poder mandarle este tipo de esta información después de la reunión.
Currently, the International Red Cross is working on helping to set up mobile satellite phones and a generator to link Puerto Rican communities who are out of touch with families.
Sí, como dije, van a estar probando generadores y teléfonos satélite para empezar a ayudar a conectar a la gente que no se ha podido comunicar con la familia acá en los Estados Unidos.
And we have a program called Safe and Well. You can go to redcross.org/safeandwell and you can register yourself and those in Puerto Rico can do the same. It's a way to find family members.
Ellos tienen un programa específico y ustedes pueden registrarse y registrar a las personas de Puerto Rico que están buscando. Es un registro para poder conectar a la gente. Se llama American Red Cross Safe and Well. Va a estar en la presentación que él tiene ahí. Vayan a la página de ellos y pueden registrarse.
Locally, we have currently 5 people who are in Puerto Rico right now, and we have more that's going to be deployed. At the start, when we were trying to deploy people after the hurricane hit, we could not get in. We actually had 700 Red Cross volunteers and staff in Atlanta waiting, and we couldn't get in. The airports were devastated, and we actually had to fly in there through military jet.
Presentemente tienen 5 personas de nuestra área que están en Puerto Rico ayudando. Ellos trataron inmediatamente de que paró el huracán a entrar a Puerto Rico, pero por la destrucción que hubo en el aeropuerto no pudieron. Ellos tenían 700 gente esperando en aviones para poder irse de Atlanta y por fin están empezando a llevarlos ahora, pero con la ayuda de vuelos militares. Thank you very much, Matt.
Thank you.
So what we wanted to do is we wanted to start with what are 2 of our local agencies actually doing? What are some resources that you all can actually lean on or your family and friend members can lean on? Queremos empezar la conversación dando la información en qué recursos honestamente existen para ayudar a la gente de Puerto Rico y para que ustedes puedan usarlo para que ustedes también pueden compartir esa información con ellos. So there's 2 agencies, the American Red Cross and the Salvation Army. We have a local presence with them and they're actually in Puerto Rico. If you have any more questions, if you want to learn more about what they said, because this may not be the right place for you to capture that, go to their website and I'm going to speak on their behalf. Reach out to them and give them a call, especially if you want to use the registry, especially if you want to consider volunteering. Many of us are talking about what can we do, and volunteering is one way to do that. We are going to show you how you can sign up to volunteer for the American Red Cross, go to participate in a training, and then be included in the possible list of people that can go out and help out, whether it's Puerto Rico or any of the future type of disasters. Very similarly, the Salvation Army has a way for you to sign up and be trained to be a member of their volunteer group. Vamos a enseñar ahorita cómo pueden ayudar en una forma específica, de cómo ser voluntario. Para poder hacer eso, se tienen que registrarse y participar en un entrenamiento con las agencias. Las dos agencias tienen esa oportunidad.
So, one of the things that at the Hispanic Center we've been getting many calls on is what can we do? You know, there are so many people trying to do so many different things. And I think it's important to realize that, you know, not only do we have those individuals in Puerto Rico who are suffering and that are struggling and that need our support, guidance, and direction, but the reality is, folks, we're going to have a migration of those Puerto Ricans that have lost everything. And they're going to be coming here. And they're going to be needing help, guidance, direction, clothing, love, grace. So I share that with you to think about, you know, if you've been thinking about, man, what do I want to do? What do I want to do? What do I got to send to Puerto Rico? I would ask you to pause and think about what efforts maybe can we do here collectively to help those Puerto Ricans that are going to be coming here, that are going to need our help and guidance and direction here. Another question that we've been getting a great deal of is, you know, we want to send, we want to send toothbrushes and soap and shampoo and we want to do care packages. And where do we send them? Who do we send them through? How do we go about it? You know, it wasn't until today, if I'm correct, today that the U.S. Postal Service is now able to deliver things to Puerto Rico, okay? Now, I still don't know what that means. I mean, you might be able to mail something to someone in Puerto Rico. How they're going to get it, I don't know. So in terms of, to answer that question, the FEMA, who the Hispanic Center has been in contact with daily, we're starting to get their daily advisories. Now, we made copies, and everyone should have a copy. If you don't, before you leave today, there'll be a copy in the back table of the latest advisory from this morning. And one of the recommendations that they're making is that to donate items, or if you want to volunteer in Puerto Rico, okay, there is an organization or a website called the National Voluntary Agencies Active in Disasters. So it's NVOAD, okay, NVOAD. The website is www.nvoad.org, okay? They are coordinating closely with the Puerto Rican government to provide assistance. Number one, if you wanted to give supplies, you go to their website and you tell them what you want to give, what you want, how much of it that you have, okay? And they will help coordinate where that supply is most needed, what organizations are looking for those type of supplies for those on the island. If you wanted to give a cash donation, okay? Organizations that are under this nvoad.org website are on the ground in Puerto Rico. That's where you know the dollars that you want to give, if that's something that you want to do, are being invested where you want to invest. So again, there are a lot of people, a lot of organizations. I know Mark Anthony and J-Lo's out there doing all kinds of things. That's all well and good. But what we just want to give you is information that we know is accurate, is vetted, and if you want to give either supplies or monetary, or you want to volunteer, this is the website that FEMA is asking everyone, directing everyone to. It's a streamlined process, and it will get to the people in Puerto Rico the most efficiently through this. I mean, what we're seeing in Puerto Rico is, again, we're starting 8 days behind, 9 days behind. And we won't go into that, but we all know we're going 9 days behind. And why is because of the logistics, the challenges of the logistics and the bureaucracy of trying to get things done has been a challenge on the island. No different with trying to give money or supplies. This is a streamlined way of going about it, and we wanted to make sure everyone was aware of this way of giving, if that's what you choose to do. Yes.
Just tack on one thought at the end of that, and wonderful what you said. Please do not just pack up a bunch of stuff and ship it. And please do not get on an airplane and just show up and ask to help. Because in all likelihood, unless you have family there or some resources, you have a real significant plan, you may end up putting yourself in a difficult situation and may not end up actually getting to help anyone. So make sure you go with an organization, whether it's
Red Cross or the Salvation Army or whoever else is doing work there, just make sure you're going in coordination with someone so that there's a plan to make sure that your safety is being taken care of as well.
So great point. And Mike Toledo is about to set up a video that highlights that. But I want to repeat that message in Spanish. Le estamos recomendando a la gente que no llenen una caja de cualquier cosa que ustedes crean que se tiene que enviar y mandarla. O hacer una colecta de cualquier cosa que la gente puede donar porque perdieron todo en su casa y se manden. Eso hace el trabajo de recuperación mucho más difícil. Además de no hacer una colecta que no esté coordinada con un grupo oficialmente, no recomendamos que se monten en un avión, lleguen ahí, y si llegué yo voy a salvar a Puerto Rico. Porque lo que mucha gente que hagan eso, lo que van a hacer es, se van a ponerse en peligro, porque no hay comunicación cuando tú llegas allá, las luces no funcionan, no hay forma de llegar de un lado a la isla hasta el otro, y lo que haces es que retrasa el trabajo que están tratando de hacer con la gente que están ahí. Si están interesados y tienen el tiempo para poder ayudar en esa forma, comuníquense con estas dos agencias. Digan, prepárenme, denme el training que tienen que hacer. Yo sé que la Cruz Roja la semana que viene van a empezar a hacer trainings para gente que quieren ir a Puerto Rico. Y después que uno participa en ese training, ellos pagan por el viaje. Los proyectos que te dan son de 9 a 14 días. Ahora, no se crean que van a llegar a Puerto Rico, vengo ahora, voy para Jayuya, o vengo ahora, voy para Cataño. No es así. Están ahí para trabajar como voluntarios. Muchas veces son días de 10, 11, 12 horas. Van a estar durmiendo en el piso o en una camita en el shelter. Van a estar posiblemente sin bañarse. Así que no es una vacación que vamos, no es para darnos la gloria que somos los que están salvando a Puerto Rico. Es para sudar y trabajar y ayudar a levantar a Puerto Rico. En lo que yo sigo bregando, yo voy a dar otro mensaje. So I'm going to say it in English first and then in Spanish. United Way has a responsibility for our local community. There are almost like 1,300 United Ways across the U.S. And everybody has an area that they're responsible for. We raise money in this area, and right now we're in the middle of our campaign. But then we give the money back to this area. Because of the magnitude of this case, of what happened in Texas and Louisiana with Harvey, what happened in Florida with Irma, and what just happened in the Virgin Islands in Puerto Rico, United Way, our local United Way, dug deep into some dollars to be able to help those communities. And I'm very proud.
So I feel like you took up because I'm delivering a message.
I'm very proud to be an employee of United Way. And I'm proud to be able to announce today to the public that United Way is making a $15,000 contribution to Puerto Rico.
Lo tengo que repetir en español y ahora a ver si las lágrimas se me quedan adentro. Yo tengo un orgullo de trabajar con Puerto Rico ahora mismito. La responsabilidad de los fondos unidos o United Way en cada comunidad es reclutar dinero y entonces ayudar a esa comunidad. Y así que trabajan los 1,300 United Way que están en el país por los Estados Unidos. Y en Puerto Rico hay uno. Pero en esta ocasión, el nivel de destrucción es tan grande. Lo que pasó en Texas con Harvey, en Florida con Irma y en las Islas Virgen y Puerto Rico con María es algo que no es lo normal. Por esa razón, la junta de nuestro United Way decidió invertir $15,000 para ayudar con la reparación de Puerto Rico, que no es lo común, no es lo normal. Así que es un honor trabajar con una agencia que sienta la responsabilidad, no simplemente por la gente que está en nuestra área, pero la gente de Puerto Rico también. Así que entró mi jefa, y no diciendo porque dijo, porque ella entró, porque lo tenía que reportar. Esta es una noticia que estamos compartiendo con todos ustedes, con un orgullo que queremos estar ser parte de lo que estamos haciendo en Puerto Rico. Así que queríamos que ustedes supieran eso. Are we ready? Technical difficulties. So we're going to keep moving.
Yes, please.
Bueno, I'm going to open it up for group comments. Oh, I really want to put some people on the spot. I feel like I'm with family. And I want to call out some of our family members. So we have our state senator here, Judy Schwenk. I want to say thank you for being here, for making time from your busy schedule to meet with us here at the Hispanic Center. Would you like to say a few words?
Well, I'd like to ask you a question.
Yes.
I should know better. Thank you, Dr. Sanchez. I agree with both Michael and Dr. Sanchez that while it's important that we provide aid immediately, in the long term, we need to be thinking about that as well. One of the things that I have done is written a letter to Secretary Rivera regarding the Department of Education about what kind of resources are we going to make available, as well as the Department of Human Services. Reading, most certainly, because we have family and friends that live here, are certainly going to have people coming as soon as air transport is available. So that's one of the questions that I want to ask. When will that start to happen? You know, when can we anticipate it? And will you, the United Way, or possibly the Hispanic Center, serve as a clearinghouse when we start to gather things locally and to help direct donations so that we get the right things that people will need, because surely they have nothing. And we're here because we're compassionate, we want to help. But we want to do the right thing. We want to make sure we provide people with the things that they actually need. So, you know, sometimes when things like this happen, people just empty out their closets and all kinds of stuff comes in, and then the sponsoring agency has to sometimes dispose of that stuff. So help us, will you help coordinate? I see people here from the Greater Reading Food Bank. We're going to certainly need a sort of a key network of agencies that will help put this together. I'm committed to help, but I hope we're thinking that way. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. So to briefly answer your question, yes. United Way has already been in conversations with the Hispanic Center in thinking out loud, how could we network our supports? How could we make sure that it's a smooth, seamless as possible? I mean, where people are going to be coming here without birth certificates, without their report cards, without their health records, without their license. How do we treat these American citizens in a way that we can transition them into something positive? And it's not something that any one of us can do by ourselves. So United Way today, we put out an invitation to our 34 plus partner agencies to be able to hear this information. And a number of you are here. Thank you so much for making time to be here. Mike already has some ideas, which I'm not sure we're ready to put out in the area about working as a collective to navigate the system for these individuals that are coming in. The video that we were trying to show, and it may not be possible, not possible? Okay, so I'll give you, it's exactly what Judy just said. When individuals want to be able to help out, many of them clean out their closets, go to their basements, go get things that they wouldn't use, and they end up in closets that then the agencies have to figure out, or on the beach and a fire has to be lit to get rid of that waste. So we really caution you from doing those type of activities. The best ways to be able to help is to volunteer through a setup mechanism and to give financial contributions to a fund that has been developed specifically for that. And United Way Worldwide has set up funds for this. The American Red Cross also has set up funds for this. The $15,000 that we're investing to Puerto Rico will be going to the American Red Cross specifically for the Puerto Rico fund. So thank you. There was a question in the back.
Thank you, Gloria. The healthcare community was invited. And I think they're here. I know St. Joe's is here. Reading Health System. I got a phone call. They're here. I don't know if Mary Carbo's here, but I know somebody from the community. So we're here. Welfare. There we go. So we're here. The Hispanic Center will reach out to their community partners and advocates because we know. The Centro cannot do it on our own. We are only as strong as the team that we have around us. This right here is a beautiful thing. What we have right now today is a blessing. Because people were telling me, Mike, people aren't going to come. Mike, you're not going to be able to get a diverse population together, rowing in the same direction around a cause like this. And to see the diversity that we see, to see the young people, the old people, professionals, nonprofit, this is what Reading is and will be going forward. But it takes us working as a collective to make it happen. So thank you, Gloria, for the question. And again, we're the Hispanic Center, United Way of Berks County, we are counting on your support, your grace, and your love to help these families that are going to be coming into our communities.
Yes.
Question for Mike. Mike, FEMA Daily Advisory that you set up when we got today, is there a way people can sign up for that?
You know? Good question.
I will have to find out on that. I'm getting it through the Hispanic Center's affiliation with Unidos US. What I can do, I believe we had a sign-in sheet. If your email is there, is out there, we can send that to you as I get them. But I will ask, and if that's something that can go directly to your mailbox, we'll make that happen.
Sure.
So I started saying that it feels like I'm in a room of members from my family, and I see Wildali's back there. I see some of our partner agencies that came all the way from the Lehigh Valley, Communities and Schools is here. I see some of our Ready, Set, Read volunteers, board members, Brad and Barbara Hall. If anybody doesn't know, I brought my mom, who's sitting right over there, and she probably can be a newscaster. She's been glued to the TV. And I'm holding hands with another very special person. Her name is Dr. Tamara Smith. She and I work together at iLead. She now does work at BTI. She's one of the people that immediately called me and said, Yamil, we need to meet. We need to figure out how the BTI community helps and gives back. Her idea is one that I wanted to share aloud with the group, and I want her to share, just because we have to start thinking as a collective. What can the Reading and Berks County community do to be able to help Puerto Rico, not now, but in an ongoing fashion? And there are many of us, many caring people here in Berks County, that this is just one project, and I wanted to highlight this one. After we highlight this one, I want people to call out some ideas that you have, and we're capturing this information to then discuss it with that coalition, that collaboration, that number of agencies that come together. But this is one that I wanted to highlight.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be back in Reading and to see all the organizations come together like this. And we already know whenever we do something like this and come together, you know something incredible is about to happen. And so I'm so happy to be a part of it. I called Dr. Sanchez because he is the man. Come on, how many of you know that he's the man? Okay? He is the man. Okay? And he's the best person I know that has the connections and just has the ability to think critically about things. And what happened was I am the program director, the new program director for the General Education Department at Berks Technical Institute. And so we are there and we have students, of course, at least 40% of our students are Latino. And so we see all of them coming in the past week, and Isabel Mantarosa is right there. She is the program director for the ELF program. We saw our students coming in the past couple of weeks. They were very sad, they were crying. And I talked to one of my students, and he has his two boys there, one 3 years old, one 4 years old, that he has not been in contact with at all. And so he came in and they were very upset and crying, and we kept thinking about what could we do. So I went to our director of education, who is Mr. James Reese, and he is always open to anything that we can do for the community. And we talked about one thing, and I said, we must do a mission trip. And this is what we are looking at now. I'm on a fact-finding mission so I can bring back the information to Berks Technical Institute. We have been looking particularly at what has been happening to the schools in Puerto Rico. Many of the students are going to be out for months and months on end. And there are some schools that have been wiped out altogether. And so we know we've been looking at Guayama. Is that correct? Did I say that right? And Yes. We've been looking there because, you know, when everything came in, it started in that area. And so they were really hit pretty bad. There are at least 45 schools in the country that, you know, have major damage. And so we are looking to take a entourage of people over to Puerto Rico to do some wonderful work. Now, I have been on at least participated in and led out in at least 7 mission trips led out by students. I have participated and led out at least 7. And the last one we did together with Dr. Sanchez. We took 60 students down to the shore after Hurricane Sandy. And we rebuilt houses, we did construction work, we did a massive amount of work there, and it was phenomenal. It's time for us to do it again. I am hoping that we can work with the businesses for Berks County. Perhaps we can work with some other school districts. We can bring some medical team on, and we will be able to do something phenomenal for Puerto Rico whenever we come together like this. So I'm thanking Dr. Sanchez and Mike. Thank you so much for giving me this commercial spot, because we're going to be working on this, and I want all of you involved. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Smith. Just to share an example of how that was actually done by United Way Worldwide after Katrina, instead of having spring breaks where college students went to islands and had adult beverages at an excessive amount, they organized college students and went down to New Orleans and helped rebuild. I personally participated on one of those trips where we had a responsibility of, in a week's time, plant 1,000 trees. Something as basic as planting trees was needed to be able to help revive that area. And it was not fun or easy work, but it was filling and gratifying. And it was an effort that was nationwide. So when we were talking about what we can do, there are these immediate things that we can do. Some people are doing them already. Drives, and we're going to show the video now that is working. We are also, people are giving directly right away. But then a month from now, 2 months from now, people tend to start forgetting. You move on to the very next thing. We can't let that happen. So we are going to figure out, how do we have a collective response? How Redding and Berks County unifies around a consistent way to keep reminding not only our local community, not only our national community, but the world community, that what happened in Puerto Rico is something that we need to be investing in long term. So more to come on that. That's just one possible idea that can be taken to the grander scale. So is there some organized mechanism to be able to get the donations down there? Communication, transportation is almost non-existent down in Puerto Rico. So really, really wanted you to think twice before we go out and set out a drive. We do think that some of you may have some bright ideas. So Dr. Smith shared the idea of a opportunity to go in and help a mission trip to be able to help schools. Does anybody else have an idea they want to share?
I don't. I want to make sure that you're...
Hello, everybody. I'm Jonathan Tinoco, president of the Multi-International Club Iraq. I'm right now by myself. I'm representative of a big team. Today, I'm here, and I want to help as much as possible, but at the same time, we want to know how to help, not interfere. Come Monday, I got to bring back a report. So I just wanted to be sure that we're on the same page and that we're just helping out. But at the same time, this is new to us because we're on a college budget. Some are parents. Sometimes people have full-time jobs, students. It's crazy. But we're trying to help as much as possible. And definitely, any way we can, people, please give us feedback. We're Iraq. We're with the community, you know, and one thing we're trying to build is a better establishment, communication, and connection with the community, just to let you guys know that we are here.
So what was your idea? What was the idea?
Pretty much store stuff. So when they come?
I hear what you said, store?
The store. Oh. Yeah, we want to store equipment. So when they come, we already have it ready, all packaged for them to come. Also, my major is social work, so my passion is the youth. So provide guidance, provide education tools, and even types of workshops so they can see the future and not just the destruction they've been through. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. Anybody else?
You have to speak up, stand up, so we can hear you. Storage. His idea is to store things so when people would come here that there are resources for them. So I want to make sure we have some understanding of the conversation is going to be at high level. We're not going to go really down into the details of some of these ideas, but we want to capture your ideas, okay?
Hi, my name is Maria Vasquez, and I am a soldier at the Salvation Army. So in my head, as I hear you speaking, what I think you guys want to develop is some kind of system so that when people come here, people who are distraught and need help can get that help, because they're going to come here and they're not going to have anything. So in my head, I'm thinking you need to develop some kind of committee that has members, maybe two members, like Miss America, you know, a winner and a runner-up, from each group or each organization, and then develop that group can develop some sort of system so that when the people come here, you have maybe, I don't know what, but some kind of form or something that they can take from agency to agency, that one identifies them, that, you know, they have come from Puerto Rico or wherever else to here, and then that they can get the help because they have come from there and they don't have everything they need, that they can get the help without having to jump all these loops or hurdles, or no, I can't give you this help because I don't have this, 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 and this. And also to try and get them, because sooner or later the government is going to be running back in Puerto Rico or wherever they come from. So to try and get them assistance to get all those identifications that they're going to need, because sooner or later it has to be in their folders at the different agencies, correct?
Thank you. I'm going to call out Kim Rivera. Kim, if you can wave hello. You probably weren't expecting this. She just started maybe 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago with the Ready Health System. And she is leading a project where 211, the mechanism that we recommend people use to be able to refer people to services, well, we're partnering with the Ready Health System to make that even stronger. And what we just heard here is an idea of how to make that 211 system stronger.
I mean, I would just say 211, you brought it up. Does everyone in the room know what 211 is? Is there anyone that doesn't know what 211 is? Okay. I mean, I think it's very important to know 211 is an organization that has information of organizations that can help and support people in need that are available 24 hours, 7 days a week. So when organizations like the Centro Hispano or Salvation Army or Red Cross are closed, you can just dial 211 and it will get you to a live person that will pick up the phone in English or in Spanish, and you share with them what your need is, what your concern is, and they will help direct you to the agency or organization that is most able to help you in the location you're from. There is a 211 in Puerto Rico. Unfortunately, obviously the communication, you know, towers are down, so it's not available right now. So 211 is something that we want, you know, push to everyone. If you're talking to your family in Puerto Rico, make them aware, let them know that once the system is back up, 211 is a resource for them.
So I'm going to put someone on the spot. She's not even expecting. I'm not even going to look at her, so I don't see her reaction. But the Greater Berks Food Bank does an incredible job throughout the entire county in making sure that those who are hungry are fed. Is there any thinking, ideas, concerns related to the possibility of an influx of people migrating here and how that would impact the work that you do? Yes, Peg. And you can give me a hug.
Come on now, Peg.
And you're going to show me love because I know I put you on the spot, right?
Lots of love for both of you. To start with, I want to say Feeding America, which hasn't been mentioned yet, is a national network to make sure anybody who's hungry receives food. They have been standing ready and have truckloads of food to go into Puerto Rico. Truckloads of water. truckloads of volunteers from all the 200 food banks in the United States. So as soon as they can get in, they'll be in. I don't think food's the problem. I think it's getting there. So everybody, as you've seen with the donations and everything, sending your can of soup over to Puerto Rico is really worthless. And I don't mean that to be nasty to any of you. But the supplies will be there. I talked yesterday with you, Mike, and whatever we can do to strengthen our network. And I talked with Tammy White from the United Way. Whatever we can do to strengthen our network for any type of influx or whatever of people coming here who need help, we'll do. We're only as strong as we all stand together. I don't have a money tree out back in my office, but we do have the ability to resource and to get donations, again, through Feeding America when there's an emergency or a national disaster, and I'm sure this fits the same situation. So however we can increase our food resources, we will. We've already had calls from our distribution sites being concerned that there's going to be more people at their sites. We've told them to wait until that happens, but we stand ready and we'll provide them with what they need. So together, as a community, as you both said, we'll take care of it.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And Feeding America, thank you. Our favorite reggaeton artist, Daddy Yankee, I know has been out there on Facebook pushing and promoting Feeding America and giving to Feeding America. Question in the back, my friend. Go ahead. And let me, and I appreciate your passion, and let me just make sure you understand the communication what's meant. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of pounds of food right now waiting in the ports of Puerto Rico that can't get to some of the remote locations because of transportation. The point that's being made is, again, as the video showed, to be able to send additional food items, things like that, it's important to know exactly what the need is to make sure that the impact that we want to have is being had. In terms of what we can do now, again, we've talked about the website that's available now for those that may want to give something now in terms of supplies. They can do that today. If they want to give cash, they can do that today. If they want to volunteer and they want to be on a team, a mission team, whether it's through the BTI that was just spoken about or the Red Cross, I believe, is doing trainings right now. You can be trained now. They're looking for bilingual professionals that once trained can go and do work on the island, you know, now. So there are efforts now to try to do just that. Yes.
So thank you so much for your passion. Today was not about debating what should be done. Today was about sharing with you the resources that are available. So for the young man who's upset, let me share what I'm doing because I too feel what you're feeling. And before this meeting, I ran to my house to go get another 6 boxes because I send my own care packages to my immediate family and friends. So there's things that you can do as an individual that we're not suggesting as a collective. It's not that you can't do it. There are 20 post offices working. And if you want them, get my number. I'll tell you the post offices that are working because I'm keeping up with this myself. So I hear your pain. I have family in Jayuya. I have family in Canovaras. I have family in Cataño. I have family all over the island, some which we haven't connected with. So the fear, the anger, the angst that we all feel as Puerto Ricans is real.
But what my role is here as a United Way leader is to make sure that as a collective, we're being smart. This isn't a political conversation. It's not about who's president and who's not. This is about how do we give you, the community, information to be able to have positive impact. There is immediate need, and people probably are dying as we speak because they're not getting medical care, they're not getting water, they're not getting food. The things that we take for granted. When I eat the last week, I feel guilty every time that I'm eating. So I feel your pain. I do feel your pain. So we're not saying you can't send a can of a soup. Go ahead.
In terms of your first question about Hispanic Center raising money, right now the Hispanic Center, unfortunately, but the reality we live in, the Hispanic Center is an affiliate of the United Way. The United Way currently is running a campaign, so the Hispanic Center cannot directly raise money for efforts like that. But what we can do is what we're doing today. We are educating the community. We're live streaming it on Facebook. BCTV is recording it live so that we can multiply the impact that you're asking for us to have, and we can have the impact that we want to have individually. Once again, as Dr. Sanchez mentioned, this is not just an initiative for today. We are looking at what we can do long term. The impact we can have long-term to help those on the island today, but also to help those that are going to be migrating to Reading in the future. I've gotten calls at the Hispanic Center of people who are bringing family members already, and they're asking what supports are there. So the Hispanic Center has been there for 50 years, will continue to be there for 50 years to help support those most in need. Any other questions or any other? Yes. And again, great question. Everyone is welcome. You're here today. We had a sign-in sheet. If you didn't sign in, please make it a point to sign in and share with what organization you're with. One of our board members, Mr. Julio Martinez, who is here, you know, he's affiliated with the pastors in the community. So the Centro has always been. Open arms in terms of collaboration and partnership. So again, this is just the beginning. Now, so know that I would say if you're not connected to our Facebook page or from the Centro's Facebook page, please like that page because that's what we're going to use as a channel to get a lot of the information out into the community and more information to come on that. So thank you for your offer. Yes.
Working together to be able to bring all these ideas and our different partners together. Yes. Yes.
And easier way to communicate. So perhaps there's an IT channel that
Yes, that's two. Now, there is a third.
Well, repository, I need 90 resources.
Okay.
Sorry.
Matthew, you wanted to say something?
Yes, thank you. I don't just see the passion, I don't hear it, I feel it. And I feel the frustration too. We're getting phone calls every day, families wanting to try to connect with their families in Puerto Rico. If you want to help now, immediately, with the Red Cross, we are having a deployment orientation on Monday from 6 to 8 p.m. These are people who, well, we're looking for people who are bilingual for us to deploy them. This would be a great opportunity to help now. It is going to be Monday, October 2nd, from 6 to 8 p.m. at our chapter office on Center Avenue. In fact, it's 701 7th Avenue. And we will go over the deployment process and what you would need to do to get trained to deploy with the American Red Cross. We are going to be having a link that you can RSVP. We don't have it now, but you can just show up. That's fine.
Before I forget, we prefaced this meeting in terms of the people who are suffering in Puerto Rico and in Mexico. And I don't want to forget that piece. As far as in Mexico, is the Red Cross, the Salvation Army, what are you doing in those parts for those individuals here that may have family in Mexico?
The Salvation Army, just as in Puerto Rico, the Salvation Army has a significant presence in throughout Mexico. And the nature of an earthquake is somewhat different than that of a hurricane, in that the damage and the need tends to be in more small pockets. And there have been multiple earthquakes. And so what's been happening is we've sort of utilized, again, our community centers, our churches, as launching points to meet needs. We're sending out, again, those disaster services campaigns with food and water and in-kind gifts for whatever the people are needing in that location. And we're also looking at other methods, but it's very much meeting a very specific need in this location. Whereas in a place like Puerto Rico today, there's no power, water, there's food problems, there's transportation problems, there's communication, all these major issues that everyone is navigating their way through. In Mexico, most places there is communication and power, but there are these small pockets. So it's almost like responding as an emergency responder to a fire. There's a problem here and here and here, so what do we do there? And adapting to those specific needs. There are many who are being sheltered by, I'm sure, the Red Cross, International Red Cross, or churches and whatnot, but the Salvation Army, typically, our role is in providing food, drinks, in-kind gifts, emotional and spiritual care, providing those unique needs that are not covered under the major efforts. Local transportation. I spent 2 weeks, I got it back about a week ago, I spent 2 weeks in the Virgin Islands following Hurricane Irma. And what I found there is I was on St. Croix and weathered Hurricane Irma, then found a military flight to St. Thomas, and then went by ferry to St. John to do an assessment. And what we found in St. John was that the devastation there was horrific, but nobody talked about that because it's such a small population. And about half of the population is quite wealthy, and they left, and left the blue-collar folks and the workaday folks, like most of us, there to endure the storm. What the problem that we discovered was that there was no medicine. There was a list. A doctor gave me a list of about 20 different medications, like serious things, like insulin and heart medication, high blood pressure medication, psychotropics for people with mental illness. Things that just were not there. It's not that people couldn't buy them because it was cash only. They didn't exist. So that's not something that there's a major
program in the world to cover that. So we find ways to make that happen. We were able to get connections through the DEA and doctors that we have who are Salvation Army officers to get drugs directly to medical facilities and pharmacists. So and then set up a vouchering system so people could actually get it because they didn't have any money. Those are the kinds of things that we're doing in places like Mexico. I can't say specifically what those little niche needs are, but I guarantee you they're being met. Are all the needs being met? Not likely. But those most critical are what we're seeking to meet. Everybody here, every disaster response agency in BOAD is our desire is to protect life and property and from our part, as a Christian community, our deeper desire is to make sure that we're caring for people's emotional and spiritual health, because these kinds of things can utterly destroy someone's life, and we don't want that to happen. We want to stand in the gap.
So another thing that you can do, connected to what he just said, is be informed as to what is the process for your family members to complete FEMA reports. Unfortunately, in times like this, there are evil people that will try to take advantage of those who don't know. So there are very, very specific things that they need to know. The Hispanic Center will be posting the forms on their website and a one sheet that talks about scams. Tell your families they should not be texting, emailing, giving over the phone, any kind of personal information like your social security number. Again, this isn't a time where scamming will go up. Unbelievably so, will go up, especially as they're dealing with figuring out how do they get whatever dollars they're able to get from the federal government for what happened. So that information will be on the Hispanic Center as soon as possible. Your question reminded me that another responsibility that we are doing, that I will be responsible in doing, is how do I network the mental health providers that we have in this community? Not only for the people in Puerto Rico, but for the people here. You know, lots of us here are connected to someone in Puerto Rico, and there is an increase of pain and suffering that we're dealing with. So one of the things that I'll be doing is reaching out to our partner agencies who are providing mental health to make sure that we do a better job in promoting their services, to make sure that they're highlighted in 211. So if someone calls saying that I'm dealing with depression because of the fact that I can't get a hold of my family, that they are connected to the right resource. So that's a United Way responsibility moving forward.
I've also made contact with the school districts, with the Reading School District and with the Muhlenberg School District. Those are the two schools. I mean, there are other schools, but those are the two schools that have a large number of Latino families there. Letting the superintendents know that we need to, you know, again, when we see this migration of Puerto Ricans coming into the area without documentation, with just the clothes that they have on their back, again, that we're welcoming those families, that the Hispanic Center is here to help them, support them around the registration, just making sure that they're welcomed, they're received with open arms, and that the children are put in a structure of education where they need to be. So again, the Hispanic Center has been reaching out to the community, to community partners that may not be here, and obviously with everyone that is here, we will be reaching out to you so we can put our collective arms around these families that we see coming in a very short order. Are there another question? Any of them? Anyone from the Homeless Coalition? Well, the ideas and what we're talking about are right now at 30,000 feet. When it comes to funding, things of that nature, that's where, you know, We look to our government for a little bit. We look to the community organizations, the foundations that are in our community. We look to the philanthropic community, but we look to every single person here. We all have some kind of resource, something we can give, whether it's monetary, whether it's knowledge-based, whether it's a supply of some sort. It's going to take the collective to be able to help these families.
So the Red Cross has been thinking about this and preparing, and if the need is high enough, we would open up a shelter here in Berks County to take those people in.
That's wonderful.
My name is Lee Cruz. When I came in here, I was talking to Mike Toledo about what happens when the families do migrate here. So not looking at it just from right now, but from when they do move in here. And I was talking to my boss, Jamie, before coming here. And I was saying, you know, people have families that they're going to bring into Redding. And time's going to go on, just like any other family member, you move into your house. And then they're going to start worrying, well, how are you helping out around here? And they're going to kick them out. You know, you're not pulling your weight around here. So we need to come up with a plan for that. Because what's going to happen is we already have homeless people here. And we're going to end up with a whole lot more homeless people here. So what's the plan with that? I like what Maria said. I'm big with community. I love community. When I first met Yamil, the first thing I said to him was, getting together as a community, everybody pulling together as one. Maria's idea about building a group, like a board where you meet. This is just one meeting that Mike Toledo has put together here. But to continue forth, you can't just bring these ideas and then next week nobody's talking about it. We got to continue forward. So I believe that we need to pick people from each organization that is here and let's do something about it instead of just talking about it.
There was a question in the back, young lady.
No, yes.
You stand here? Oh, wait. Hold on. Young lady, go ahead.
I can't answer specifics here, but I would love to have a conversation with you because this is the first time that I'm hearing, that you reached out to United Way. So I would love to make sure you have my card and my cell phone and we figure out some logistics to make sure that what you're doing is effective. I, as a Puerto Rican born, I will not tell you not to do something. But as a leader of community work, I am not looking to be able to make the work that they do more difficult. So I have to split myself. And I'll be more than happy to talk to you offline as to how I can help you by giving you some technical support and advice to make sure that it's productive and that it's helpful. I want you to be successful, because you may be able to get something to some of my family members that these agencies aren't able to. This devastation is so severe that it is all hands on deck. It needs your passion and what you're doing, as well as these efforts. So I applaud you for being so angered and so empowered and so motivated to make it happen. And I am not going to squash that at all. Now, I've never heard of it, so I'm looking forward to, before you leave today, that we connect. Okay?
Agreed.
There may be an opportunity.
No, él tiene que venir al frente porque tiene está representando con la camisa.
Carlos Zaya, un jibarito de Puerto Rico aquí. This is a hillbilly from Puerto Rico, okay? My concern here, when I came to this meeting, is that we are going to have the opportunity to exchange opinions, impressions, comments, how we can best serve the best interest of the people, the victims of this hurricane, you know, the people affected by the hurricane. It's easy, we are here in the comfort, but they are in a different situation there. When you are listening people here, there, that they don't have water, you know, the situation changed. And right now, I don't see why we cannot have two different approach. One for the long term here in Berks County, for whatever happened here as a consequence of the Hurricane Maria and others, and we need to react just now, not in 14 days, not in 15 days, not in 20 days, with people that go there and cannot communicate. We need to act now and see how we can help, for example, these young people, young leaders of Reading and Berks County that have been collecting goods, because I disagree with the lady, with all respect, that said that it's worthless to send a can of soap there. I disagree with that. If that person understand or think about that, it's because she don't know which is the situation on the ground. We need to move fast, and we need to act now to help in the short term. And that doesn't mean that we are not going to become involved in the long term here. We can do both. We can multitask and we can do both. But just to focus on raising funds locally for the local agencies through United Way and Centro Hispano, for me, is total error. Total error. I know that Mr. Torres, our barber, we don't have more Mr. Torres here. But I know he was here, he will be running since day one, since last Friday, because this meeting is a week in arrear. We are late a week. We should be doing this last Friday. And I understand that we can do both, and we can talk about that. We can agree, we can disagree. But we can have an approach short term to resolve the issue of the emergency now, not focus just on getting donations here for the Centro Hispano and United Way locally, because in Puerto Rico, we have the Cruz Roja Americana. This is the American Red Cross Puerto Rico chapter. And we have website, we have phones. I know that we have limited communications right now. This is improving. And we have the United Way, Fondos Unidos de Puerto Rico there. This is the United Way in Puerto Rico. If we want to expedite the help, don't donate here to the United Way here and to the Centro Hispano. Donate immediately to the Red Cross Puerto Rico chapter and Fondos Unidos de Puerto Rico. This is my concern here. Because right now, we need to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. This is bureaucratic, and this is bureaucratic. We need to expedite the help. Right now, there is a lot of goods that they are waiting help to put them in containers to bring them to Puerto Rico, because those that are in the port, they are going to be distributed. But what happened after that? The emergency is so great. Let's help the people of Puerto Rico now. And we can help the Centro Hispano United Way locally later. But we have something situation in the ground there, and we need to deal with that. Thank you.
No se me vaya, porque yo quiero, yo quiero que me escuche. Voy a empezar en español, porque quiero que el grupo completo entienda esto primero y después lo decir en inglés. Esta, esto no es porque estamos haciendo una campaña para United Way por Centro Hispano. It's not about the campaign for United Way, the Hispanic Center. Yo personalmente conozco a Sammy, el presidente de Fondos Unidos. Yo personalmente he hablado con los empleados de Fondos Unidos en Puerto Rico, los cuales están recomendando que la ayuda que ustedes quieran dar, que la dé a la Cruz Roja. Porque ellos no pueden hacer nada. The Puerto Rican United Way is disabled. I personally know the president of that United Way. His name is Sammy. He's been there for a long time. He loves the Puerto Rican community. And he is the one that's saying, you need to invest. If you want to help us by investing in American Red Cross. So I hear you, but the reality is not what you're sharing. So
American
I
want to, Red Cross, Puerto Rico. It is part of American Red Cross.
We have the American Red Cross that's working
Fondos
with them.
Is part of United Way.
It is. Fondos Unidos is United Way.
You don't need to win the bill.
No, but Fondos Unidos is not functioning. Right now, they're not working.
You are, when you were talking about that, this is 8 days after the hurricane. Are you really aware of the situation now before yesterday? Or today.
We are in constant communication with. Right. So we have a really great relationship with Fondos Unidos, and right now they're suggesting that we work with the Red Cross.
Why? I don't see any of you providing information about American Red Cross Puerto Rico or United Way Puerto Rico, Fondos Unidos, and you know that there is people here, a lot of good that people in Bexar County, churches, and everybody, including Mennonite Church. A pastor there that donate a lot, they have a lot of good to right. send to Puerto Rico. And you, both of you, never become involved with these groups. It's a shame.
You're absolutely right.
No,
you're absolutely right that it's a shame. And I'm glad you came forward. So hopefully after today's meeting, I'm now aware of a group that's bringing good together. So the passion that you have can die out. We're not trying to kill out that passion. We just have to be able to work smart together. Yes. I'm sorry.
That's great.
This
is about, again, we're only as strong as the team we have around us.
We got places, drop-off. You got 13 Union Elementary School. You got the 1600 block of North 13th Street. You got a Barrio Alegría collection.
What I'm hearing you say is you have the drop offs. You want to figure out how to continue this and how to get it to Puerto Rico, right? Okay, we want to have a productive conversation, and that means that we need to have one person. Okay, you were going to say something.
Thank you.
So we're not all knowing. You coming here and sharing what you're doing is beautiful. That is the point of having this happen. As a result of you advocating the way you did, believe in me, some people are going to walk away thinking, how do I help that group? We need to connect so we know, and we include it in the notes that we can make figure out. I believe that we need to do all things. He said it. I agree with him. It's not just what the government is doing, and not just what these agencies are doing, but it also requires people like you. So you're on the radar because you weren't before. I never heard of it before. So I'm looking forward to talking with you and making sure that we continue to share with people what you're doing and figure out how we help you.
Okay, listen. This young lady right here has your solution for your stuff.
A very small solution, but my name
is Jovi. Get over here. She's coming over here. And if that doesn't work, I read on Facebook that Jay-Z gave Fat Joe a plane to take supplies to Puerto Rico, and they're meeting Saturday at 59th Street.
Okay, so my name is Jolise. I work in so many aspects, but I'm representing myself today, so no, I'm not affiliated with no one today. Just a small something that could probably help you. My friend, I can give you his information afterwards. Everything's legit. He works for a company, and they're sending a small charter plane on Monday morning from Philadelphia to Puerto Rico. On Sunday, I am personally, because I have been doing the same thing you guys are doing. I follow you guys on Facebook as well. On Sunday, I am going personally delivering things. But there are specific things that they need because they can't take food, just, I guess, because of logistics with them. But they do need certain things. He has messaged me. Everything's legit. I can give you all his information. So maybe if you guys want to send stuff immediately, this could probably be a small way of you guys lessening the load just a little bit, and it will get there by Monday night. So that's an option. And also for your idea for the mission trip, I'm a graduate student doing my counseling degree in Kutztown University, and I'm pretty sure if you reach out to them or Alvernia or anyone, they're more than likely to do the spring break trips with the mission trips as well.
We want to be respectful of everyone's time. You have about 10 minutes remaining. I know you wanted to say something here.
My thought was, we in this room are used to.
So again, in order to be able to have a productive conversation, we have to minimize the side conversations.
I think a lot of us in this room are used to this environment, working together, coming up with solutions. But if we start inviting at least one person from a for-profit business to the table and talk to them, apartment owners, how many vacant apartments do you have? Can you give them to us for 90 days? Storage unit owners, do you have storage units that we can use for 90 days? And start asking them to come to this table, because they're for-profit business owners. They don't sit in this world every single day. So they go home and they see the 6 minutes on the news, and then they have dinner, and then they're done, and they get up and they go to work the next day. They're not involved in the strategic thinking and the strategic planning. So I think we should start working and reaching out to them and bringing them. They have money.
Thank you. Any other questions as it relates to... Yes?
So, but my question is, how can we send or will we be able to send any materials or
Okay, so let me see if I can answer that question. So the question was, when can we send things to the island? And again, I'm going to recommend right now. Okay, through this website. And again, if you have, if you got this, this is at the table before you leave. Please make sure you pick it up. It's from the FEMA. Okay, the last page. You can go to the website www.nvoad.org. On that website, you tell them what you have, what you want to send. Okay, where you're located, and you send that information, and they will get in contact with you to let you know Yes, we'll take it or pick it up, things of that nature. That's the website you can go to if you have something you want to give now. Now, the post office just today has started to be able to you can send things to Puerto Rico, but it's not to every post office. It's to what?
There's a list of about 20 post offices, and delivery won't be made to the home. People would have to pick up packages at the U.S., at the actual postal office. It's on USPS.com. If you go to the United States Postal Service, and there, if you do a Google USPS, it'll say Puerto Rico postal system just became active. If you click on that link, they'll list all the cities that have working post office. From 9 to 3.
Yeah. The serving hours, they go from Puerto to Puerto working. Like if you send that package with alimentos 70 pounds, you have to find out first if the Puerto post office is working for them to get that package.
Okay. Thank you.
So for your first question, I'll answer. That's beyond our scope. So we don't know what security measures. As a family member, I too am concerned if my family member walks out with a box of stuff in the post office, who's worrying around the corner? But that's beyond what we do. We can't help you with the answer to that one. And then your last question, as far as what you just said, non-perishable food items. So things that won't go bad, canned food, wrapped crackers, those type of things, but non-perishable. They don't. You're not allowed to send lithium batteries over the mail. I found out, but you can send D batteries in the mail.
Now the post office did send the Hispanic Center some information. We're going to put that on our website for you to take a look at. If you do not have computers at home, the Centro Hispano has a computer lab. That lab will be made available to you to go online to get the information that you need. Those are the things that the Centro can do and help with. The Centro is open Monday through Friday, 8 to 4. Okay? So we can help support you in those ways with those kind of questions.
Did you want to say anything? Yeah, I just said, what I'm doing is I've been sitting here and listening most of the time. And what I'm hearing is a lot of broken hearts. I'm hearing a lot of people who are feeling anguish over what to do, how to do it, and getting upset over these barriers that we're coming up against. But you see, that's the purpose of this, to overcome those barriers. Now, many of the barriers that we're facing, especially with getting things to our loved ones, are beyond our control. But I want to give you some encouragement. From FEMA's situation report at the end of the day yesterday, I spoke with our incident command team in Puerto Rico, and some of the barriers I mentioned earlier, the ships capsized in the port area. The storm also, because I was asked to look into the Facebook reports that there are containers of food and truckloads of stuff in the port, and it's blocked up, and there's nobody to drive them, and no trucks. And that's partially true, and partially untrue. The issue is getting the ships, the container ships, into the port safely and getting them unloaded because most of the cranes in the port were damaged and they're not usable. So there's very limited crane for container movement off of the ships onto the piers, from the piers to where they need to be, and roads being impassable have been difficult. The military, since FEMA took over the operation a couple days ago, the military has moved in and essentially unloaded on these problems. They're cutting up the trees. They're moving the lines. The containers that are in the port that aren't getting out will be out very soon because the military also has a lot of trucks and a lot of truck drivers. That's happening. Things are, right now, we see a snapshot. But having been in the disaster areas myself many times, know that it's not a static scene. People are working around the clock, tirelessly to overcome these barriers, to find ways around the barriers, because it's about the people who are there. Everyone who is there is there for the same purpose, to make sure that people are cared for and loved and their needs are met, short-term and then long-term. Now, the supply, I guarantee the supplies are there. I know because Feeding America gets food from USDA, Department of Agriculture. The Department of Agriculture makes all of its national reserves of food available in a disaster, free to the disaster area. So there are truckloads of 53-foot trucks full of skids of every food imaginable that's canned and dried and you name it. So I guarantee you that the help is there and it's on its way. So please don't feel desperate. And remember the threes. Simple things. Three seconds. A human can live 3 seconds without oxygen. Or 3 minutes without oxygen. I apologize. 3 minutes without oxygen. 3 days without water. And 3 months without food. So, as uncomfortable as it may be, and as much as we all want to alleviate these problems, our friends may be hungry, our family members may be hungry, but help is imminent. Help is on its way. The Red Cross is there. We're there. Churches are there. People who don't have an affiliation with any organization are there. They're helping. The government, as whether we agree or not, the government is there. The military is there. Help is there, and it's increasing day by day, moment by moment. So no, I want you to be encouraged that your families are being cared for, and everyone is doing their very best to do more and more every day. So I want to leave you with that.
Thank you. We are going to... We're going to conclude this meeting today, but this is just the beginning. For those of you who want to continue to be engaged in the process and want to contribute to the work that we're going to try to do to help those in Puerto Rico now and into the future, if you signed up when you came in and your email address is there, an invitation will be extended to you. Again, we welcome and we appreciate you all being here. We know that you all have passion and purpose behind what you want to do to support those in Puerto Rico, and we greatly appreciate that you're here. Again, this is just the first step.
I want to finish by saying there are some of you who didn't get a chance to speak, share. You still can. So hopefully you have Mike's information. You can get my information from United Way's website, or I have cards here that I can give to you before you leave. Just because you didn't speak, weren't able to speak in front of this group, doesn't mean that your thought, your idea, your concern is not important. So we really want to hear from as many people as possible as we figure out how we move together as a group. So, yes? We are. That's why we said we make sure you need you to sign in with your email address, and we will continue the conversation and bring everyone back to talk about next steps. Okay?
Yes.
I mean, this is not anything rocket science, but I was hearing a lot of frustration about logistics. And there are big networks of private pilots that do mobilize in situations like this, and they have been getting through. I don't happen to know the specific organizations of the private pilots, But for the folks that are trying to get something going right now, that might be the way. But people have to be trained to go into very small areas and very small airstrips in order to be able to do that work effectively. I did think, however, and I mentioned to my colleagues that we have an airport here in Reading that is very underutilized, and it could be a staging area for some of the private pilots to come in and out in an effective way. So it'd be worth exploring.
Great idea. Very good idea. Thank you.
Laura's always good for a great idea. Laura, thank you so much. Again, please keep the ideas coming. Dr. Sanchez mentioned his email address is on the website of the United Way. My email address is on the Centro Hispano website. Please, let's continue the dialogue. Thank you again for your commitment here this morning. If you parked in the Abe Lincoln and you have your ticket, please bring it up to me and I'll sign off on it so you can get out of the parking garage. Again, thank you so much for your passion. Have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you, everybody.